Hello, everyone. And welcome. I hope everybody had a very illuminating and warm Chanukah. And as we wind down the solar year, I wish everybody blessings in every possible way, actualizing your deepest potential, all in good health, and abundance materially and spiritually. I say it also being that I'm just coming off my own birthday yesterday, so I have special powers to bless. I probably wouldn't have mentioned it had Mark not dedicated the class to me. So we'll begin with that, dedicated to yours truly, by Mark and Rebecca. And also in honor of my birthday, the 5th of Tevet in Hebrew. It's also an auspicious day, especially in the Chabad world. It's a day of called the redemption of the books. Not sure how to title it exactly. It's still under development, the title, working title. And also want to say a refuah shleima to Tzipi Bat Nuski, a friend of Sandra's, mother of Sandra's, who's a good friend of Kenny's. You know who that is?
Yeah.
Do I know her? Who's that? Okay, fine. And of course, anyone else that may need any type of other blessings in healing or in preventive healing, preventive medicine. So, I guess one of my favorite themes is dealing with the unconscious. So that's what we'll be discussing. What lurks beneath mapping the unconscious? One of the mystical discussions around Chanukah is about the significance of oil, specifically olive oil, Shemen Zayisach, because that's the essence, the core of the Chanukah miracle and the Chanukah story, is lighting flames, which is very unique among all the holidays, all the Jewish holidays. But most holidays don't necessarily have one specific thing you do. It's a series of things. And Chanukah is mostly the festival of lights. And as the Talmud asks the question, my Chanukah, what is Chanukah, what miracle does it commemorate? And the answer given is that in the days of the Second Temple, that would be something like 2,300 years ago, 2,200 years ago, approximately, the Jews, of course, in every generation have another empire or nation to contend with. Well, this time it was the Greeks, the Greco-Syrians to be more specific. And they had then conquered and defiled the temple. That's how the Talmud puts it. And they defiled all the pure olive oil that was used to light the menorah on a daily basis. And after a war between what was called the Hashmonaim, or the Maccabees, as some know, and the Greek army, and the victory, they were able to find, miraculously, only one cruse of oil that was left untouched, and that burned, even though it was only enough for one day, it burned for 8 days. That's the basic story that we all hear. But, obviously, when you think about it, it doesn't seem like such a big miracle at the end of the day. I mean, there were a lot greater miracles, seemingly greater events. So the mystics explain the significance of oil, which is the key emphasis as well in the menorah in the temple. The Talmud says, the verse says, that you shall light a eternal flame, ner tamid, and should be made out of pressed olive oil, shemen zayizach, pure olive oil, with the emphasis that it be pressed. And of course, all oil that comes from olives has to be pressed. So, in the Kabbalistic literature, especially in the Zohar and the writings of the Arizal, and then later in Hasidic works, what big discussion about oil. And as well in context, for instance, we're talking about it in comparison to wine, and in comparison to water, and all different other liquids and foods that we consume. So as the mystics map it out, they look at the whole universe in a very unified way that each component of existence is symbolic, or actually you can say an embodiment of spiritual energy. And the different ways we process different types of foods and drinks are part of a spiritual process that manifests itself in physical terms. So the way they would say it is that in existence you'll find things that are, we'll call them conscious experiences, and there are things called unconscious experiences. And to put it in more layman's terms, there are things that we see on the surface and there are things that are beneath the surface. Now today, in a highly scientific world in which we live, it's increasingly obvious and doesn't need any, you don't need to make a case, and definitely does not require faith to know that the most important forces that shape existence are invisible to the eye. Whether it's in the human body on the level of the cell, our human cells, or chromosomes, or genes, or DNA, these are all invisible forces and microscopic elements that shape everything. Or in the larger universe, be called microscopic, would be the idea of subatomic particles that are really the building blocks of existence that in turn join together and turn into atoms, and atoms turn into molecules, and molecules into elements, and elements into all the phenomena, all the objects, and all the experiences we have in life are a combination of some configuration of these similar forces. Now, there's still the elusive search for the unified field principle that Einstein, till his last day, could not discover, remains a mystery, but scientists would say we have it down to a few basic laws. So as diverse and as multifarious and the universe may be, billions and billions, if not trillions and trillions of components, there are a few basic laws that unify them all, a few simple components that just are different combinations. In the computer world, in technology, it's called zeros and ones. So zeros and ones, just combine them in different fashions, and that you have all basic programming language. So when you see an A or a B on your computer screen or on your mobile phone, you're not seeing a physical A or a B. You know, once upon a time when we used typewriters, you typed an A. It was an A. Even that, one could argue, is just to the naked eye. But I remember the first time that we called it cold pressed. Now, those used to be called, well, the reason they called typesetting, because actually there was setting type once upon a time. Many of you have ever seen a linotype? Everybody's too young to have seen a linotype. Well, I've seen a linotype. My father was a journalist, and I remember visiting him in the newspaper. So the good old days, how it was done. When I say good old days, we're talking about the early 80s, the mid-70s. There was this big machine. I can't even describe it. It looked like a, you know, like from the Middle Ages. And with a keyboard attached to this big bag, and there was a big vat of lead, boiling lead, with a hard piece of like a bar of lead going, dropping in, and the typesetter would type letters, and these were engraved in lines of type of lead, whatever words. So it was actually type. Every line in the newspaper was typed physically, and then there were the typesetters. They would take these type and they would read them backwards and learn them out in a mold, then add a picture, and that became a page in a newspaper. Once it was proofread and so on and corrected, it would be put under a printing press, ink would go over it, and newspapers would print. I don't know if I gave an accurate description, but that was more or less it. So I remember the first time it was computerized, a typesetter I knew, he said to me, "I don't trust computers. What's going on? Is there a little man inside the computer that's doing the typing now?" Because for people who were very much involved in it, could not understand how letters are being produced. And the truth is, we all really don't know how they're produced. They're just produced. We know they are. Because in some way, we figured out how all this whole process can be digitalized. And once it's digitalized, so what you see is a letter A is a digital, it's just an image of an A. But make-believe all of existence maybe is that same thing. The surface that we see, the sky and the earth, the birds and the bees and the plants, mineral, vegetable, animal, and the human being, maybe the outer surface is simply what we see on our screen, when in truth it's all about zeros and ones and inner forces that are shaping it. And this isn't such a wild concept, because it's exactly the way the mystics describe, have always described existence. That existence is simply the outer expression of inner sublime and spiritual forces that when they're mixed and combined in particular formulas create what we see. To just give an example that everyone can relate to. When a person cries, hopefully tears of joy, and tears come out of your eyes, so no one in their right mind would say that first you cry and then you feel sad or happy. First you have a feeling. Now a feeling cannot be quantified in physical terms. What does a feeling look like? You only know what it feels like. You know, we know sadness because if you've had sadness, you can identify and empathize with someone else's. Same with joy, love, and so on. But for some reason, when we do have sadness within us, in some way has some type of psychosomatic and physiological impact on us, that when it overwhelms us, it will build up and teardrops will build up in our tear ducts. And at some point, that will burst open and erupt in tears. Now, scientists and researchers are trying to understand all the details of it and so on. But there's no question this is what happens. So it's not a far jump to say maybe all of existence works this way. When it rains outside, so yes, a weather report will tell you take an umbrella or a raincoat. A meteorologist will give you all the weather patterns and the pressure systems and the highs and the lows. You know, and for some reason there's people very interested in it. That's why you have it. Every newscast, and then you have the Weather Channel 24. I know. I guess it gives people a sense of control, or they think like they know what's going on behind the scenes. When really it comes down to just call up somebody in Cleveland, and more or less that weather is coming here, combined with so on. I'm not trying to knock the doctors of meteorologists and so on, but the point being is that there are forces behind the scenes, and what we see is just the tip of the iceberg. So when you look into the Kabbalistic writings and Hasidic writings, that's exactly how they describe existence. If you really understand something, you cannot define it by its surface. You have to understand the forces that shape it. In healing terms, it means you don't deal with things on a symptomatic level. You deal with things on a root level. So a symptom level is you see you have a cut, you put on a Band-Aid. On a symptom level, you have a headache, you take an aspirin or a Tylenol or an Advil or the different... names that they have. These are dealing with symptoms. And roots is dealing to the core issue, what's causing it to be that way. So when it comes to superficial matters that don't really go deep, okay, fine, so you deal with something on a surface level, not so bad. But when you're dealing with core issues, important issues, like relationships, why is my relationship not working? Why am I having difficulty finding a long-term, committed, trusting relationship? Or with anger issues, or with just our general emotional vulnerabilities and fears and so on, there, in most cases, surface solutions don't really work because it's all being driven by inner forces that are most, in most cases, invisible to us. So basically, we don't even know what the forces are shaping us. It's like, just like you would say a volcano and an earthquake, unpredictable because the forces that the pressures that build up are hard to really analyze. And even with all our modern tools and geological knowledge and so on, still an earthquake is impossible to predict. There's odds, you know, once every 20 years, once every this year, they're faults. But you really cannot know because the forces under the earth are mysterious. And with all the gauges and so on, it's very hard to know and predict when it's going to be the next earthquake or the next volcano or so on and so forth. So how much more so with a human being who's far more volatile and we have far more moods than the nature does. And we also screw ourselves up far more. You know, nature has its own way of balance. Human beings, there's a lot of human error involved. And human error just complicates all matters. So to understand the unconscious is really to understand everything. It's to understand what shapes you, who you are, how you react, how you make decisions and choices, how you deal with confrontation, how you deal with relationships, and so on. Everything, literally everything. Everything is shaped by forces that are visible to us. So I would say it would be quite invaluable, to have a peek and be able to map, if one could map the unconscious, would have a tremendous new way of looking at yourself and at other people. Because you'd have a map that is defining not just the symptoms, but also what drives and helps us understand those inner forces that shape everything else. So we're going to talk about that. Now, you may ask, how do I know about this more than, let's say, anyone? If we all are blinded to the unconscious, so where do I get this inside information from? Well, there's two ways. One we'll call experiential, and one we'll call from sources. One of the things that struck me as a younger man many years ago, when I began to explore my own Jewish roots and Jewish scholarship, maybe one of the biggest things that struck me above all that resonated was when I began to read some texts, Kabbalistic and Hasidic texts that map the unconscious. So I wasn't so taken by the fact that they're mapping it, because there are many books out there, including Far Eastern disciplines, as well as psychological, that some of them do a very good job of understanding deeper forces. So many good books have been written about this. And you have romantics and poets and novelists and artists that have all tried to capture in some way the inner forces. That's really what actually all art is. All music is really doing that. Trying to get beneath the veneer, beneath the routine, and try to understand or touch a part of ourselves that is invisible. But what struck me most was not the attempt, was that the resonance of it. You know, when you hear a song and it touches you, you don't need scientific proof that it's touching you. It just does it. And when you hear a story or you hear an insight that resonates within, and you know in your deepest gut is true because you wonder, how do they know that about me? These are the things I began to recognize. And after a while, studying more, I realized it wasn't a fluke, that consistently there was this map that actually describes you better than you ever can describe yourself. It's very hard to deny certain truth to that. So I'm not here to prove it empirically and with scientific proof. That's why I call it experience. Experience is that when something resonates and then it works in your life, frankly, that's a pretty good, that's pretty good for me at least. You know, someone said to you, look, I want to prove to you that music touches you, and they'll hook you up to all kinds of monitors and take your pulse and your heartbeat and then show you, here's what happened to your brain waves and your heart waves when you heard music, and you suddenly see how it all becomes stimulated. You say, now it proves that it touched me? No, who really cares? That may be good for a laboratory. If it touched you, you'll know it touched you. You don't need any monitors. On the other hand, if someone shows you on all the monitors that it's supposed to have touched you and you didn't feel anything, what value does that have? So obviously we all can be manipulated, and obviously we can all be susceptible to certain things, but if you use your mind and discretion, and you are skeptical, and you look at something, and time and again it proves itself in its resonating truths, it's something worthwhile looking at. So I'm not suggesting here that anybody has to take anything at face value. I challenge you to do exactly what I do. You can look it up in the sources. But I will share some of what I've learned, which I really do every week here, but here I'm being more specific and going straight into describing what the unconscious looks like. Now, the second point I wanted to make, which was more the experiential, besides the resonance I mentioned, is, you know, how can you describe something that's fundamentally invisible? Now, this question actually was posed not to mystics or to religious spiritualists or to to people of faith. It was actually posed to one of the great physicists of the early 20th century. And the challenge was that you scientists, especially the quantum mechanics, the quantum scientists of modern physics, the new physics called quantum mechanics, were coming up with all kinds of bizarre, literally bizarre conclusions that at the time were completely weird. They're still weird. But at this point, no one can deny them because they've been replicated so many times that it's impossible to deny. But if you did not know that, you'd think they're completely crazy. You know, that concepts that were literally wiping out hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands of years of scientific theory. You know, just to use the most basic example, in quantum mechanics, everything is in a state of probability. Nothing is definite. It's called indeterministic. This was anathema to anything that was scientific. Science, especially after Newton, was always based on absolute prediction. They call the billiard ball effect. You hit a billiard ball in a certain angle, with a certain strength, it will always, 100% of the time, will have this reaction. Action, reaction. You throw up a ball, it'll come down. Unless, of course, the environment changes. But with the same conditions, it will always have the exact results. This is the foundation of science, predictability. Obviously, you have to replicate it again and again and then until you can say, absolutely, I will throw up a ball right now, it will always fall, without exception. And that always that held up, whether it was due to the theory of gravity or other theories. But bottom line was, that was definitely an empirical fact. You throw something up, an object, unless it's lighter than air, it will always come down. Suddenly, in quantum mechanics, all this was upset that there's a state of probability and you cannot predict. Different conditions, you can never know, or the way Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. That's what it's called, an uncertainty principle. Tell me what that means. That itself seems like a contradiction of terms. How could something uncertain be a principle? But it's called an uncertainty principle because it's proven time and again that you can never know the position and the velocity of a atom. Which is strange. What do you mean? Why can't you know the position? Like, say a car is driving on down the street. You know its position, you know its velocity. How could you say that's impossible to know? And the point there is not impossible, not because we're lacking data or we cannot observe it. It's because even if you were there and had all the data in the world, it's fundamentally unpredictable. These ideas were completely bizarre. Einstein rejected them outright as seeing what he called it spooky physics. You know, he used the expression, God doesn't play dice with the universe. To which Niels Bohr, another Jew, responded to him and said, don't tell God what to do. This was the discussion. So the point being is, so one of the physicists was asked a question, forgot his name, it'll come to me. He was asked the question, how can you come to all these conclusions? And they're bizarre. They're absolutely counterintuitive when no one ever even saw an atom, let alone a subatomic particle. Until this day, we've never seen an atom. We don't even know what an atom looks like. The model we learn in high school that it looks like a bowl of cherries that's black and white, electrons, and surrounded by electrons, neutrons and protons, is just a working model to make it easy for us to understand. That's not necessarily how it looks. No one ever saw it. That's just simply a way of looking at the cluster. So his response was a classic response, and I'm using it particularly in the context of the unconscious. His answer was, with an analogy, he gave an analogy of a fisherman who spread his net across all the seas, and he was going to gather fish of all types and shapes and colors, and then document them, and have this type of, universal map of the fish in the sea. Anyway, he began documenting everything he found, and then he came to realize a very interesting conclusion he came to, and that is, all the fish that he documented, of all the colors and shapes and sizes and so on, there were no fish that were shorter than a half inch long. So he was about to make an announcement to the whole world, a brilliant thing he realized, that there are no fish that are shorter than a half inch long. Now, you don't need to be a fisherman nor a scientist to know that there are fish that are shorter than a half inch long. So his little child saw this conclusion, and before he was about to announce it to the whole to the wizards of the world, his son, like the story with the emperor and no clothes, says to his brilliant father, he says, let me see the net you used. I myself have seen fish that are shorter than a half inch. They look at the net, and yes, lo and behold, miracle. The net had spaces that were half inch, the ropes. So all the fish that were shorter than a half inch fell back into the water. So the scientist's conclusion was correct. He just had to qualify and say that when you use a net that has half-inch spaces, you'll never catch fish that are shorter than a half-inch long. But let's be honest, you don't need to catch fish to know that. That's an obvious conclusion. The point that he was making is, what instruments are you using? You're asking me to prove subatomic particles with what? With instruments that cannot experience that microscopic dimension. So then how do we come to the conclusions and how do scientists come to conclusions about something that no one can see, no one can hear, no one can taste, touch, or smell? Subatomics don't fit into any sensory, the sensory tools cannot observe them in any possible way. The answer is what's called in science extrapolation. You do it through the effect of the atoms. For example, if you speed up particles, so though you don't see them, there's an effect that they give off. So though you don't see it, you see its effect. So either through very high levels of acceleration or high temperatures will cause something to change its properties. And then you see by the effects, you can see what what it's like. So you don't see it directly, you see it from its impact, which is how we observe and understand black holes and so many other things. You do not see it directly, you see it indirectly. You see it by its reflection or by its impact on its environment. So let's apply this now psychologically to the quantum psyche. Is the same thing with the unconscious. And I'll use an example I've often used, which is, take an imaginary invisible wall. There's a wall that is in your proximity, but you cannot see it. You have no idea what it looks like. But you know there's a wall there. Or you assume there's a wall there. And you can't shine a light on it, and you can't touch it. Is there any way for you to figure out what this wall looks like? Or if there's a wall? And if yes, what shape it's in? Yes, there's one way. The way is to bounce a ball off of it. You throw a ball, and you see how it bounces back. So you're not going to see the wall, but you'll see how it bounces back. If it bounces back, you know there's something there, number one. If it bounces back straight, so you know whatever that part of the wall must be straight. If it bounces back to the right, so you know it has to have a left wedge. And you keep bouncing and bouncing. At some point, you can get a picture of the wall through its through process of elimination. It's called in Hebrew, Yedias Hashlila, through the negative. You get a picture of the wall by seeing how it keeps bouncing back at you. So let's apply this in human terms. A truly trained and empathetic counselor, coach, what they call today a therapist, a psychologist, whatever word you want to use, what was once simply called a soul doctor. I didn't say a witch doctor, I said a soul doctor, which was really the essence of what a rabbi was, a soul doctor. Not an administrator, not a fundraiser, not a politician, a diplomat, and so on. A soul doctor, an expert on soul. So what is an expert of a soul able to do? It's not magic. He knows how to bounce the ball off your unconscious, which simply means that when you have a conversation with someone, so you don't know what's going on beneath the surface, just like that person themselves may not even know what's going on. But what you do is, in the conversation, through certain pointed questions, or through certain leading the conversation into certain sensitive areas, you can see how a person reacts. So it's like the ball. How does it bounce back to you? So when a doctor, you go to a doctor, a physical doctor, and you ask a doctor, you tell the doctor, I have a certain pain, let's say, in your finger. So the doctor will feel it, and feel that, you know, then you get to a point where, oh, that's really hurting. And it gets closer to the more sensitive and tender point, you know that there's something going on. So a doctor who's trained can then isolate and eliminate the causes by what he feels. But he doesn't see what's going on beneath there, just like you don't see it. But because he's trained, he understands from the symptoms. So if you touch a place and you really jump back, you know that's the problem. Same thing is psychologically. When you speak to someone and you go to a certain area and they want to avoid it, they don't want to speak about it, that's because it's a tender place. So obviously a sensitive soul doctor is not going to go on an all-out assault and just to hurt someone or to just go to a place a person doesn't want to talk about, but you've identified by what people avoid, you learn more than by what people want to talk about. So interestingly, a really trained person doesn't learn by what you say, they learn by what you don't say, much more than what you say. So when you, let's say, describe your problem, so you think that the person who's a wise person is going to learn from what you're saying. They learn 90% of what you don't say. They learn how you describe a problem, what you identify, because you're going to identify the things that are easiest to identify, the ones you're aware of. You won't identify the things that are most uncomfortable. And not even maliciously or intentionally, it's just the way that works. Just like when someone touches a very raw nerve, you pull back. It's the nature of the human being. In other words, our immune system, even our denials are all indicators. So people usually think of denial as a negative thing. You know, you're in denial, you don't even realize it's a problem. It's negative if you just stay there, stuck there, and you can't move from there. But it's not negative in context of indicating what's going on. Why are you in denial about that area? Because there's a reason. Because it's too painful. It's too difficult for you to deal with. That alone tells us something. Why is it so difficult? Why couldn't you handle it? Now, this is not automatic. This obviously needs a lot of he's a trained person, because it's not just a matter of having a conversation or two, it's also coming to terms of figuring out what to do about it. That's obviously the more complicated part. But before you do anything, you must have a diagnosis. And you can't have a diagnosis of a person's unconscious without bouncing the ball. So there are two ways that we learn about this unconscious. One is actual texts that talk about it. And there are actual texts that discuss the unconscious of a human being, and as we'll soon discuss, the unconscious. And then the second aspect is observation, or as I said, experiential, by engaging in conversations, by learning from experience. And you can learn much about yourself when you realize these methods and techniques. Obviously, at the end of the day, there's always a third component that's necessary, and that is objectivity, which you can't really provide yourself. You have to have someone else who can help present or approach and look at something without the blind spots and without the biases that each of us has. So that being said as an introduction, what it really requires, therefore, to really get to understand oneself or someone else is firstly is realizing how little we understand. Realizing that our perspectives are about the conscious. We do not really know how to relate to the unconscious. The unconscious is really out of our control, which is the first problem, because therefore there are things that how you react to certain things are completely beyond your control, because it just become the way you do things. Why is it, for example, if somebody presses your buttons and provokes you, some of us will lose it and others don't lose it? Are we just wired differently? You know, some of us have to deal with anger issues, uncontrollable anger issues. So doesn't mean all the time, but unpredictably, at certain points, people just have that way of reacting with a tantrum, with anger. Now, everybody's got their so-called quirks, but some can also be very destructive. In most cases, unless you've done damage, unless real damage has been done and you've been forced to do something about your issues, or you've hit rock bottom, most of us just live with it. And either we brush it off and ignore it, or we hope it doesn't pop up again, or whatever else, all the other ways we cope, or we have all our coping mechanisms. Or some of us are what's called functional addicts. We've learned to function, even with our stuff, and we just manage. Is that a ticking time bomb? Probably. But for many of us, it's like the known evil is better than the unknown, so I'll stay with the stuff that, as long as it's not destroying the whole world, unless I don't have to deal with it, I'm not going to deal with it. Now, I can't go ahead and profile everybody, because we're sitting in a room here with many different people. Everyone's got their level of awareness and their issues. Some of us have worked things through more than others. So I'm speaking, obviously, in more general terms, but I believe, not in general completely, that some things that can be applied to each of us individually. So the motivation to want to dig and understand yourself better on that unconscious level, or to understand someone else that you love or someone you care about on that level, is a key component. If you have no motivation, if you think your life is working on the surface level, on the conscious level, all is fine and good, yeah, very difficult. And I would not recommend anybody to go force someone to enter into their so-called unconscious state. But most people who are somewhat self-aware, especially if they have a measure of honesty or integrity, and do always feel they want to grow, they're never self-satisfied with saying, you know, I'm just content, everything is great. People like that usually are looking to dig deeper. Not to cause trouble, but simply to search for deeper truths. Deeper truths in their relationships, deeper truths with themselves, and so on. But I have to again state, there are many, and I'm sure all of us are guilty of this at some times, that we're self-delusional. Or we minimize. Or we lie to ourselves. We deceive ourselves. And I'm not saying this as a critique. It's just a matter of self-awareness. If you're really in a place where you're trapped in that type of self-preservation, or whatever you want to call it, contentment and self-interest that is driving your life, the most likely that you're not really going to be receptive and open to digging deeper into what's beneath the surface. Because why would you? If your comfort zone is strong enough, why would you? Is it hot in here? Or just that, since I'm talking about the unconscious, it's getting hot under the collar. I just want to know. Yeah, maybe we could turn off the heat or something. Huh? Okay. Yeah. I know sometimes I said the topic. They say if it's hot in the kitchen, get out, right? Okay. So. No? I'm talking a whole class here, how everything's under control. You tell me it's not in our control. That's what I'm saying. Okay. So, that being said, so I gave that first disclaimer, or the first opening statement, that after the introductions I've given, that's a critical component. I can tell you, testify to this personally from many experiences I've had. People come speak with me about all kinds of matters. And as much as people profess that they really want to hear the whole truth and nothing but the truth, and they want to really be open and so on, because who's going to say, listen, I'm self-delusional, I don't want to hear the truth. I mean, you don't find many people who just declare that up front. No. At this point in my life, very little disturbs me. So this is just important to state. As I said, when people tell me that, I have to make my own judgment. Not that I judge anybody, but I have to make an assessment. Sometimes you come to realize that a person, as much as they declare their openness to everything, many, I would say, that are not really that open. And I usually don't tell somebody if I recognize that, because there's no reason to hurt them. I try to hint it, or I try to suggest, are they really open to another perspective? And after a few tries, if a person is simply not open to another perspective, they have it all figured out, obviously I say to them, listen, if you have it all figured out, what do you need to speak to me about? Just do what you're doing. And so until a person acknowledges that, why are you coming for advice if you have it all figured out? But people do that. One of the reasons people do that is because they want validation. They want to basically, you'd agree that they're not the problem, that someone else is the problem, or something like that. And if you don't agree, they don't always like that. So you have to know how to figure out how to walk, tread gently. And as a person of integrity myself, I try to do the best. But there are situations where you simply have to say, I don't know really what I can do to help you. I mean, I'm more than happy to talk. But at some point, a person has to be open to something different if they really want change. You can give advice and so on and so forth. And then, like one therapist once told me, and she said to me, she's a pretty top, high-paid therapist, and she's not a believer in real healing, to be frank. I said, so why are you taking money from clients that there's no real healing at the end of the line? She says, listen, some people need someone to talk to. And no one wants to talk to them. They have to pay for someone to listen. I mean, she didn't say it quite so bluntly, but that was essentially the gist of it. And in her mind, she feels she's helping with that alone, just offering that camaraderie. So I say, why don't you suggest to the person to find some real friends that they don't have to pay? So you have a little conflict of interest here. Why? Well, if you have a paid friend, why do you need an unpaid friend, basically? You get the idea. Now, I'm not exaggerating it, because this happens to be true in some cases. But I'm not here to criticize or vindicate or condone or in any way. Everybody's got to find their right therapist if they think they're good and they work for you, by all means. But unfortunately, nothing works if a person doesn't want it to work. Nobody can help you if you're not open a little. Total closed, and you expect someone else is going to open you up, it doesn't work. It's definitely not sustainable. So the challenge, of course, in all this type of discussions is that people like to talk about the exotic. I can't tell you how many people have asked me in my lifetime to help them discover their previous lives and reincarnations and dreams and interpretations of all the invisible forces. And there's no question, especially in Jewish mysticism, there's volumes on these topics. So it's like the Judaism doesn't have what to say about it. But there's one key foundational principle that comes before all these books, and anyone reading these books knows this, that unless a person is ready to be responsible for their lives and act on that, all this exotica just feeds into sensationalism, and it almost becomes a scapegoat and a crutch. Because if I could find my previous life, that like then it'll enlighten me. I'll really know what my issues are. Like one great mystic and Rebbe told somebody who asked him to interpret dreams, and we know there are dreams interpreted in the Bible, in this week's chapters about Joseph and so on. He said, it's hard enough for me to figure out what to do while we're awake before we get to our dreams. So let's first figure out what to do when we're awake. And as they say with real Kabbalists, they say in Kabbalah, they say, those that know don't say, and those that say don't know. What do you think about that? Which really basically disqualifies anything I'm going to say now, because if I say, just to put myself in a trap. But there's a third dimension. When I say that those that say don't know and those that know don't say, those that know don't say everything. They say what needs to be said, and those that know how to hear and understand it will understand it, and those that don't won't get it. That's how it works. That's how I've seen. So the greatest Kabbalists I've seen in my life, not that there were many, were always very discreet people. They went out into sensationalism. They definitely didn't do magic tricks. And they did not feed into people's need for sensationalism or for exotic and for the mysteries. People that would not talk about mysteries are the people who you can trust with mystery. Because mystery is meant to remain a mystery. That's why it's a mystery. The question is, how do you access it in a way that makes you a more responsible human being? So this is not about like, okay, let's get now, I'm great. We sign up, we're going to go for a trip into the unconscious, and then it's going to be like, you know, amusement park, a psychedelic experience or whatever, let's look forward. Trust me, you probably don't want to go for a trip into your unconscious. Not exactly so pleasant. So there's a reason it's meant to be unconscious. It's meant to remain there. When Moses, is the sound working? When Moses asks God, show me your... We may have to cancel this class. It's like a lightning. So, what was I just saying? So when Moses asks God to see the face, God says, no man can see my face, no human being can see my face and live. So without going into a long discussion on this, clearly right there means that Moses was asking, and God was saying, because certain things you can only see by not looking. That's the bottom line. And the unconscious always will remain unconscious. Just like subatomic particles will always remain in a probability state. That's the way they should be, and that's where they have to be. The problem is our insecure psyches and the insecure world that we live in has difficulty accepting there's some things that you cannot control. See, the greatest people in life were the people who celebrated their vulnerability and not afraid to not be in control of certain things. Love is not in your control. But we live in a paradoxical world. We want control over it, over something that's not controllable. And that alone is the source of much misery in relationships. You're trying to control something that's not controllable. Because the nature of love is emotions. And emotions means there's vulnerability and there's unpredictability. Just like the subatomic, it's quantum. Love is quantum state, not Newtonian physics. It's quantum-like physics, if you want to put it that way. So in talking about the unconscious, therefore, it's critical all these so-called axioms that I'm stating here are all part of the actual discussion. I know you all think this is like introductions. You can't wait. Let's get into the unconscious. But these introductions are more important than the actual discussion, frankly, because they tell you the tools, how you access it and how you tread and how you relate to it. So that being said, so what do we know about the unconscious? Their entire volumes, as I said, discuss it. And I can tell you what books they are. But trust me, if you read it, you probably won't relate to most of it. Not only because it's in Hebrew, and not only because it's cryptic, but even if you're able to interpret it. And even with a good teacher, it's because you have to earn your way to enter. That's the key. You see, in the material world, on the surface level, how do you earn your way? It's usually with money, with connections, status, favors, and so on. That's how you get into places, right? In the spiritual worlds, in the unconscious world, you don't get in with all those. Those things don't help. No money in the world, no connections, no status is going to help. There are tools how you get in, but the tools are tools that are ones that we have to cultivate. These include integrity, okay? Integrity you can't purchase. They include true love and empathy. They include selflessness. They include effort. They include respect and awe of something that's not in your control. And if you think you can control it, it will always remain elusive to you. It's when you let go, is then when your unconscious begins to speak to you. So in a way, the unconscious and the conscious are actually at odds with each other. Because if it's revealable and controllable on a conscious level, it's not the unconscious at work. The unconscious does not work by the same terms and rules as the conscious world does. Yet it shapes everything that's on this conscious world. Like I said before about subatomic particles. There was a book a few years ago that said the most reliable machine on earth is based on the uncertainty and improbability principles of quantum mechanics. The machine is called a computer. Computer is completely reliable, or else we wouldn't be buying it. It means you can always get the same results on your calculator and your emails and your lists, and everything you have is consistent. Yet the computer is based on quantum technology, technologies that are based on uncertainty. So that means, strangely, uncertain principles are what create certainty. Now, I know that may be hard to understand how that's possible, but that's part of also entering into this world, is realizing that paradoxes are not a problem. You see, paradoxes disturb us because we live in a conscious world of logic. And everything is like, 2 plus 2 is 4, and it's not 5. Someone said 2 plus 4, 2 is 4 and 5, it throws us on a loop. But it throws what in a loop? It throws your conscious in a loop, not your unconscious. Your unconscious is very comfortable with paradoxes. As a matter of fact, most of life is paradoxes. Look at your behavior. Most of our behaviors are very paradoxical. We got, and we don't have big issues with that. We don't like paradoxes that are outside of us. But we ourselves are walking paradoxes. You feel one thing, your mind says another thing, and you do it anyway, even though it's supposed to not be good for you. How many times do we do this a day? Where your mind, you know clearly this is not the right thing to do, and you do it anyway. Tell me that's not a paradox. So when you look into these books, when they map it out, part of it, as I said, you need to know what tools and instruments to use as you enter. So what does this unconscious look like? So I go back to what I was speaking about Hanukkah with the oil. And here's how they explain it. I mentioned the surface level. So the surface, the value of the surface is because it tells you, you can observe it. Like I said, you see tears coming out of someone's eyes. If you're sensitive, you realize those tears indicate a source, a cause. And that cause is sadness. And then so you address what's going on beneath the surface. So in other words, everything in life really are indicators. If you're able to look at your conscious life, literally the things you do today, walk around, where you went to, who you visited, what office, work, home, everything you did are all indicators. None of it is really a power of its own. Now, this takes a lot of training to come to those terms, because we think, what do you mean? The things I do, that's what shapes my life. That's true, but that shapes your outer life. They're all indicators of an inner world that's at work. Someone who's truly trained sees in every experience some inner force, some inner story, some deeper choreography, if you wish. Some people call it Hashgacha Pratis, a map. Sometimes we see it very visibly. You meet someone, you think you're meeting them for one reason, and you end up becoming very close friends, or something comes out of this meeting that you never expected or planned. They call it serendipity. There's all kinds of interesting words that are used. But they all indicate that there's something more than what meets the eye. But the challenge to get there is, as I said, is control, insecurity. We want a plan. We want to figure it out. And I'm not suggesting you shouldn't have a plan for your life. But if your plans lock you in and you're totally airtight, you're never going to be able to see the inner forces at work. Until sometimes, as I said earlier, when things break and things aren't working, then you've got no choice. Then you have to go beyond your so-called script. So in describing what's beneath the surface, the way the mystics put it, is they say there's two levels, generally two levels. Its truth is there's infinite levels, but two general levels. One is called the unconscious. Not really the word used in Hebrew. The word used in Hebrew actually is the secret dimension, the hidden dimension. And then there's a thing called the hidden of the hidden. So Razin and Razi the Razin. There's the hidden and there's the hidden within the hidden. And these aren't just two levels of hidden. These are actually two fundamentally, qualitatively different levels. So let's just use an example. We'll use an example of the human, of our own physical beings. So you have, for example, let's start with the mind. The mind. You have an idea that comes into your mind thousands of times a day. So it's very hard to even retrace the steps of where an idea comes from. Because by the time it enters into you, you're aware of it. So a second or a moment before, you weren't aware of it. So that spark that's sometimes described like a flash or a spark of an idea, where does it come from? Now we know our minds have more than one idea in it. Your mind right now is storing probably millions of ideas. This is a collective amount of knowledge and experiences that you contain within you. Many things you just take for granted. You learned the ABC years ago. It's just inside of you. When you speak a word, you're basically using ABC without even thinking. Automatically, you're accessing your, let's call it your hard drive, which is, in most cases, invisible. And when you access it right now, and I say the word 2 plus 2 equals 4, or when it's night, it's dark outside, and when the day sun comes, when the dawn breaks, it gets light, just using just a simple thing. What you're doing is retrieving into your conscious mind something that is lying there, sitting there, but you're not aware of it, not conscious. So that would be called the hidden. But it's not really hidden, because it's accessible. Someone just has to spark it. It's accessible all the time. I'll give you, let's say, a riddle or a problem. So if you, whether it's a mathematical riddle or it's a different type of question, you're going to go into your memory banks and try to answer it. Either you'll have an answer, you won't have an answer. But if you have an answer, it's going to be somewhere that was stored earlier. It's not like you're going to come up with it now. And all you did was retrieve it. So there's a whole, let's call it body of knowledge. I'm using the mind as an example. That's inside of your brain right now. That is hidden for all practical purposes, but not impossible to retrieve. The same thing is on the emotional level. Feelings that are also stored within us. And we will react. We may not react right now because you don't have the situation. But if, let's say, something that usually attracts you or usually repulses you and suddenly you see it, you're going to have that reaction. Because it's already embedded in you, the memory of those feelings, and you just need a catalyst to bring it out. So that would be called, I mean, I don't know if it's, I don't like to use the word unconscious because I don't want to confuse it with unconscious that many of us are familiar with, whether through Freudian psychology or this whole discussion between subconscious and unconscious. So I'm using my own terms. So forget about the word unconscious, purely the semantics of it. Just think of it, let's call it a hidden state that is not as non-conscious. But it's clearly there, and it's just a matter of retrieving it. So to use the example of a computer, yes, you have a hard drive. The hard drive has a lot of files on it. You don't access all the files all the time. Once in a while, you press in here, you know it's there. You may even forget that it's there, but it's still there. So there's also levels, the things you remember, things you don't remember. But then there's a whole other qualitative state. And that's really where it gets obviously far more complicated. And that's what we call the unconscious, which is the raza, the secret, the hidden within the hidden. And that's things that may not even be on your hard drive, so to speak. You may not, in other words, even if you look for it and search for it, it's not retrievable, but it's still inside of you somewhere. And those are the things that obviously are the biggest shapers because they're the ones that are completely beyond our grasp. So when they explain it, they explain that wine that comes out of a grape is considered to be the first level of the hidden. And the oil that comes out of an olive is considered to be the second level of hidden. It's far easier to get liquid out of a grape than it is out of an olive. That's why olives need olive presses. Now, grapes also have grape presses, but they're not with the same type of intensity. Now, what's the idea of the press, pressing of a grape, of an olive? So the Talmud says, Hazayis, the olive, does not produce oil until you press it. Which is essentially, in simple psychological terms, that most of us do not produce the best we have until there's pressure. There's a deadline, there's a competition, there's something that is some tension, something resisting that's causing you to surge forward. If you don't have that so-called resistance or tension, you're not going to get the best out of that person. That's why with athletes, they have to have very good competition to bring the best out of them. So they have the drive to want to overcome. You know, you have to run back in order to jump forward. So you always have to have that type of deeper tension to bring out deeper strengths. Which is why, if you really want to access deeper energies in a person's unconscious, one of the key things is you have to be ready to be challenged and ready to be pressured. This doesn't necessarily mean a negative or unhealthy pressure. This is basically, you can impose upon yourself very healthy pressures. You know, whether you want to achieve something, you commit to something, and that forces you to, you know, you have a deadline, you're responsible to someone else, you're accountable. So there are ways that we access those inner strengths. But once you get into that type of state, and I just gave the example of emotions or intellect, I'm going to use the example now across the board, what we call the 10 faculties of a human being. So the 10 faculties break into two groups, emotions and intellect. So there's the conscious intellect and there's the conscious emotions. Those are the things that you're very aware of and you experience in a very obvious way, in a very, you're very conscious way. Then there is the un, which is within your capacity to access and retrieve. It's just right now, it's not there. But that is definitely a deeper level, because that is usually where you're usually in a healthier level than you are in your conscious. And then there's the deepest level, what's called the core faculties. The core faculties are not even in the shape of a faculty. They're just on the, think of it like, let's say you have a source of energy. And before, from the source, the source is the generator of energy, then it transmits a general, emission. Maybe a good example would be sound. Let's use sound better than energy. So let's say you take a flute, so you have the flute without, you just blow through a flute without any intonations, you just get a flat sound. Then you use the holes and you cover them, then this sound begins to take on shape. Same thing when we speak. You can just make a sound like a voice, a sound that comes through your lungs, through the pressure, through your throat. But the sound doesn't have any shape and form. It requires what they call the hei metzoyes hapeh, basically your lips, your teeth, your palate, your throat, that create the specific sounds of different letters. And when you combine them all, you have, if your person, for example, has the ability, their mouth and all the five different gutturals are all intact, but there's no sound coming through, that would be like having a good flute, but there's no one blowing through it. On the other hand, if you have the sound and you don't have any type of, for example, if this, God forbid, damage to the palate or to the tongue or to other parts of your mouth or throat, it can affect your way of communicating, a lisp, or to the point where you don't even communicate at all. So when you say that person, for example, has difficulty communicating, it's not the same like in school. We always had kids in class. Some were brilliant, but they were very shy. And they were misunderstood as being stupid by someone who was a misunderstander, someone who didn't get it. When in truth, what that was lacking was they didn't have the expression, but they had all the wisdom inside of them. Then there are people who have the gift of gab, and they can talk and talk and talk, but they have nothing to say. So you could have expression, but you don't have a lot of content. And often people are misdiagnosed completely based on a very superficial analysis. So it's critical to understand, when you look at a person, to understand what is missing here. Is it the expression from the unconscious to the conscious? Is it something on the root level, the core level, that goes even before the actual sound? So you have really three levels to really talk about. One, going from the outside in. What you observe, that which is retrievable but not on the surface, and that which is not even retrievable, that is all the way in the core level. A true soul doctor is able to go through all these three levels. Many therapists can maybe get to the second level, and they're not able to go to the third level. Third level requires far more, not just wisdom, but requires far more, I would say, empathy. You have to really have a deep sincerity to be able to enter that place, because that place is not just accessible because you want to go there. It requires a very deep selflessness to allow that to emerge. You know, for example, someone may say all the right things to you, but you still don't trust them. You ever have that? You meet somebody, they say everything right. On paper it sounds great, but you don't trust them. And not necessarily because you're a distrusting person and you don't trust anyone. Just something about them that you don't trust. What is it that you're getting? I mean, it could be wrong, but let's just say you're not wrong. What you're getting is that they're saying everything right in the conscious. They may even be saying things on the unconscious level that's accurate. But something that is undefinable is just rubs you wrong. Children sometimes sense it. They just sense something about a person that's not lovable. We remember as kids, there were the few ogres, you know, a few of these the older people, who kids just hated for no reason. It wasn't because they looked at those faces and they saw that they saw these older people hating kids. So kids, like, were scared of them. And these things are very deep levels. They're not unconscious levels. Because a person could be smiling to you and doing everything right, and you still, something rubs you wrong. So when you talk about the experience on the deeper levels of trust, there it's far more than just knowledge, far more than just a deeper understanding of human behavior. You're discussing now a level which is very, very hidden. So when you look, for example, at a flame that's burning. Let's say we just learned Chanukah candles. So you know the flame is a wick that's absorbing, being fed, being nourished by oil. Okay, if you're using oil, if you use a candle, it's being nourished by oil. And that oil, as long as it lasts, this flame will burn. Now, if someone were to show you oil, someone were to show you fuel, and you never knew that this fuel can burn, would you ever imagine that it has power to burn? No. You know, for all practical purposes, it looks like any other liquid. Well, how would you know? Unless you tested it, or unless someone told you. So, there you go. There you have something that, on the surface level, doesn't look like fuel at all. But when you do the right things, suddenly this thing becomes a fuel that can give off light, flame. So the question is, inside of ourselves, how much fuel do we have like that? That is completely unappreciated and inaccessible because we don't even know it's fuel. We don't even know what it can yield. Well, all we have is what we see. You know, you see somebody, you say, okay, here are their talents, the skills, here's their experience, here are the mistakes, the trial and error, the things we've done in life, our achievements, our failures, our accomplishments, and so on. So a good friend or a good mentor or a good counselor or a good coach or therapist could help a person dig a little deeper and realize that they have potentials that are inaccessible, that have not yet been accessible. But that's still retrievable because it's not really fundamentally in a different realm. It's basically, it's like, think of it like the difference between a coal, a hot coal, and what I just described as the fuel. A hot coal, when you look at it, you may not see any flame at all. It's white, it's just lying there quiet, looks dormant. When you blow on it, or you fan it, or you touch it, God forbid, you suddenly realize it's quite hot. And it could. So the flame is there, but it's in a concealed. That's considered to be what's called, in the Hasidic terminology, a helem sheyeshne b'metzias. It means it's a concealment, but the concealment has substance. It's concealed from us, but it's not fundamentally concealed. But what about the coal before it was even lit? Or like the fuel before it was lit? Then it's in a state, you can blow on it, you can fan it, you can touch it, and it will not give you any flame. Or another example sometimes is the flintstone. A flintstone. Flintstone doesn't have any, you can break open a flintstone, you're not going to find a flame in there, or a spark. But when you strike it with pressure, go back to the pressure, it can release a spark, and that can create a flame. The interesting thing is, you throw a hot coal underwater, it's going to be extinguished. You throw a flintstone underwater, it doesn't lose its spark. It doesn't lose its flame, because the flame doesn't have what's called substance. So that's called a concealment, or an unconscious that's not has no substance. But it's absolutely there. The only thing is, to get it out of there, you need a lot more pressure and a lot more effort. But it's clearly there. So when we look at a human being, and you talk about mapping, you map it in these three steps. There's the conscious, what we know, what you see. There's the unconscious, which is not visible, but it's like the flame is hidden. It's existent. Like I said, the hard drive, it's just a matter of retrieving it. Sometimes retrieving may not be easy. I'm not suggesting it is. And then there's a whole level that is not even in the category. You can't even call it that it's in any way accessible without some type of special effort. Now, the purest you is on that third level. That's the purest you. That's actually the part of you that nobody could have ever affected, because as I said, even if they throw your spark underwater, it's not going to be extinguished because it's not subject to the conscious forces. The unconscious is subject to conscious. You could, as I said, you could extinguish it, you could access it and so on, because it's in that realm. So there's a part of us, the good news this is, there's a part of us that actually is never damaged goods, no matter what happened on the conscious levels, or even on the unconscious levels. So when we talk psychologically about, let's say, a child growing up in a dysfunctional environment, or any form of abuse, or any substance abuse, and so on, things that have affected our lives. From a Torah point of view, they affect the conscious and the unconscious at most. They cannot affect the unun, because the unun is not subject to your actions. So essentially, you have a part of you right now waiting to be released that probably has never been touched in a real way. Now, I'm not saying never. When we have real experiences of love, or for that matter, pain, they can touch that place. But it's just a touch. It's not really, you're not actively living on that dimension. So essentially, the real you, and I say real intentionally, the double real, not the real you. So there's the outer you, there's the real you, and there's the real you. Let's put it that way. The real you is probably, most of us have not seen much of. And when you do, you know. Because those are real moments of truth. Those are real moments where our undeniable true experience takes place. And in most cases, it's a very humbling experience. It's a state of sense of awe. Your ego is not in play. Your self-interest is not in play. It's a very profound type of experience. And in most cases, it happens unexpectedly and probably unplanned. But it's always there. The whole point of Torah and all its mitzvahs and all its exercises and methods is to access that third dimension. But you can only get there through the first two, because there's no way in. How could you get in? You have to use your conscious tools to go there. You have to want to go there, which is why I preface so much at length in the beginning the prerequisites that are necessary to begin this journey, which included some of the things I said earlier about selflessness and about how we have a need for control and stuff like that. So basically, all the things you consider your strengths, I can't say all, most of the things you consider your strengths are probably antithetical to entering into the real you. I know that may sound a little harsh, but it happens to be true. Which really means that the so-called projected you, the you that you project to the world and to yourself, and even the you that is remains somewhat concealed but not inaccessible, is an outer dimension of what you're really possible and capable of. And when you throw into the equation all our social interactions that reinforce all the time your projected you, you can imagine that the script and the profile that you see yourself, if you were to fill out your profile, is a very far cry from that real you. Now, the interesting thing is the goal here is not to enter to that third place and stay there. The goal is to take that and bring it outward, that the unconscious and the conscious should be informed by the real central you. So in mapping out what I said earlier, the unconscious, what we do is like this. You take the faculties that you're aware of, and that calls Chachma, Bina, Das, Chesed, Gvura, Teferes, Netzach, Chayid, Yisayid, Malchus. Just, I'm not going to spell them all out right now. If you're familiar with what I just said, great. Now, I have spelled some of them out in the Omer book I've done. But essentially, it's the spectrum of conscious human experience. They break, as I said, into intellect. I will give you a short summary of them. Why not? But I don't want to go into the details of each one of them, because that alone is a series of classes. So your cognitive processing is three ways that you process, and in order. There are people who are great conceivers. They are innovative, creative. They come up with ideas all the time. There are others that are very good developers of ideas. You give them an idea, and they can flesh it out like far better than the conceiver can. Usually people who have chachma are not necessarily good at bina. And people who have bina are not necessarily great chachma. So chachma would be the conceivers, and bina would be the ones that really develop it into detail, break it down, implement. And then there's das, which is a third cognitive tool that comes at the end of a process. That's like people who get it. There's a certain dimension, intangible, where it's almost like aha type of thing. Where, aha, I get it. So it's not just understanding, and it's not just knowing. It's not just, it's not just understanding, not just comprehending. It's like a type of knowing. I know it to be true. And this is not intuition. It's a process that comes at the end of really studying something enough times until you come to really resonance maybe be the right word. And then there's the seven emotional emotions, which briefly are love or attraction. And then the antithesis to that is repulsion, or love would be being drawn to something. Gvura would be moving back, withdrawing, holding back, withholding, like discipline. Then you have compassion or empathy, and you have fortitude or ambition, and then there is humility or yielding, there is bonding, and there is dignity. Each of these, of course, is a world of its own, and if you want to know the profile of a human being, what you want to do is create the configuration of these 10 and how they interact with each other. Because we all have the 10, but we have different measures of strengths and weaknesses. Some of us are strong in one and weak in another. And then there's how they interact with each other. Some people are very good chesed, love, but they don't know how to stop the flow. They don't know when to stop. They have the foot on the gas all the time. They don't have any brakes. And then there are people who only have the brakes. So it's all about a proper formula, a proper combination, blend of these spheres. Now this, what I described as conscious, this can be mapped out, where you can, more or less, with the right questions, actually get yourself a very clear picture of what you are on a conscious level. You know, you could find out how strong you are in chesed, how strong or weak you are in gvura, teferis, in each one of them. That's one level. But that only gives you the you as you know yourself. The next part of the map would be layer two, which is, what are the hidden forces that are not completely inaccessible, but shape? Like, why do you love this way? Is it genetic, because you were born this way, or is it because you adjusted and compensated for things in your life? So that's why you developed a certain way of being chesed, certain way to love, certain gevura. Some of us have been hurt, so we have a lot of defenses up, and we don't let people in. They're not necessarily natural to you, it's just what you developed. So there's a whole second map which gets into the roots, the root causes of why your conscious faculties are functioning a certain way. And then there's the third map, which is obviously the most complicated one, and the one that needs the most training, and really to be able to get a sense, and that's the you that is beyond even the parts that have shaped you, and the root of your conscious. This is like who the quintessential person you are. If untouched by anything, what would the freshly fallen snow look like? And there too, each one of us has our own map. Our own map of what your faculties are like and what your potential is like. It's like the fuel that has not yet even ever been ignited. So you have the so-called software, the hardware, and you have what's even behind the hardware in that level. So in describing this map, as I said, there are different names for it. I mentioned a few of them. But above all, what I would like to say that I leave everybody here with, and leave myself with as well, is it's not an overnight trip, a journey. It's not an overnight course that can just teach you how to do all of this. It's steps that are required, and if you do them consistently, you can develop and understand yourself in a completely new way. Literally everything. How you react to things, how you don't react, why you get upset, why you don't get upset. A way of understanding yourself and everyone around you. So I would suggest the first steps is really what I said earlier, is you have to realize, and you have to be open to realize that what you see is not what you get. It's the first step. It's just simply knowing that the outer experiences, the projected experiences, are one level, and there's always something beneath it. As I said earlier, if you're not open to that, I really don't know how you can go on this journey, because what's going to compel you? So that's one thing, is simply exercises, which is why we have, for example, in the Jewish tradition, we have days, we have moments, we have tools to do this. In the morning when you wake up and you say Moda Ani, you acknowledge God for returning my soul to me. Or any other time of prayer, which is like an oasis in the day. Or Shabbat, which is once a week. These are all moments and times that are meant, designated for you to create some type of space so you can focus on this. Because as long as you're on the merry-go-round and running at 90 miles an hour, you're not really able to even see anything beyond the moment. It's all a whiz. You know, one big whirlwind. So you have to somewhat stop the rush hour. You basically have to slow down slow down your faculties that are in high octane drive, be able to just even be able to stop and look. And then, of course, having good friends and good community, family, or people to talk to are all part of the tools that help a person look at that part of themselves and begin to travel inward. Then there are obviously experiences to go to the third level that are harder to do, but I would not begin there without first getting to the second level. You can't go to the third station without the second station. But the first thing is simply creating such a discipline in a person's life. And discipline can take on everybody can have their own formula for it. I mean, I'd be happy to help anyone if they're willing to start do this. I can make suggestions, but I would rather make those suggestions that are really more personalized and customized, because there's no one size fits all. But there's many things you can do on your own, and obviously it's simply stopping and slowing down or creating that space to get to that type of level. Now, as I said before, because of subjectivity, it's always helpful to have a guide or someone that goes along with you, or you can have a sounding board, serve as a sounding board. I will say, however, that this doesn't mean you have to wait months or years before you get to the third level. It just means that you need to begin creating some discipline, some space. Then the third level begins to speak to you far more than you think it does. You see, it's like almost like a child that's in hiding. Will not come out until you're ready for it. Like the student, when the student is ready, the teacher will come. There's no way you can force it, because that part of you remains essentially undercover, waiting for you to be, humble enough, and vulnerable enough, and courageous enough to access it. So you can't yank it out. It's going to emerge as you apply your disciplines. But there is a map there, and the map goes back to the 10 spheres that I described, the 10 spheres of structure. And the map is spelled out in specific detail. If you have a copy of the Omer book that I've done, you can look at it right there. It's pretty much mapped out. So you just get a sense, a lay of the land, so to speak, of what you look like. What do you look like in the mirror? I don't mean the physical mirror. In the spiritual mirror, in the psychological mirror. So, coming from Hanukkah, when we celebrate the flames and the lights, Hanukkah is about bringing out that deeper dimension of the oil within each of us, and realizing that we have within us fuel you may not even know is fuel. Fuel can take on shape of many things. It can be positive experiences you've had, and even more so, negative experiences, because negative experiences have taught you things that are a fuel to grow in the future. Like they say, Hazayim Bedima, when you plant, you sow with tears, Berina Yukseri, you will then reap with joy. So sometimes the tears in our lives and the negative experiences actually are catalysts, are food, fuel, seeds, and fuel for growth. So whatever it is that you've gone through in your life is part of your journey. And when you look at it this way, then you're no victim of anything. Everything is part of accessing your third dimension, which then informs your second and your first. It's just a matter of sticking with it, being around people that encourage and give you confidence in this journey, because you're not going to get it from the street. You're not going to get it from people who are basically worshiping the surface level. And it's all about, as I said before, things that you can control, you can buy, status, and so on. Here, the journey requires a whole new set of tools that are not those that are necessarily so valued in our world. So, on that level, we're able to reach very pure experiences. You know, I did want to make one mention before I conclude. And obviously, all of America is traumatized somewhat by what happened in the Newtown, Connecticut. No matter who you are, whether you know these people or not, the fact is, when you know innocent young children are massacred like that, I don't think there's anybody that can be immune to that or desensitized, because it really doesn't matter you're liberal or conservative, whether you're a Republican or Democrat. You know, children are children, and that's like the place that we all believe should never be touched. You know, we all know we're all going to grow into adults, but as long as you're an innocent child. So when you see something like that, of course, I can't see how it doesn't hurt us all. But there's enough pundits out there commenting on what has to be done to prevent things like this, whether it's mental health or gun control or all the other stuff. So there's enough others giving all kinds of thoughts. I just want to throw one thing in, which is connected to somewhat the theme I was discussing here. You see, children are the closest to the third dimension, because they're not tainted yet. They're not affected by other things. For example, just go over to a three-year-old child and say, here's $1 million. What do you think the child's going to do? They probably will just ignore it. Well, for that matter, if it's a billion or a trillion, it wouldn't make a difference. What does that tell us? Who's closer to the truth, we or the child? Right? So we probably, most of us, think, hey, the child's naive. They don't understand what the power of money is. I would say, I think it's healthy the child is that way. And the longer, the better. Not that money to me is not a blessing, you could do many good things, but there's something about children that is close to another reality that is completely almost impossible for us to relate to. The beautiful thing is we were all such children one day. So we see people torn away, their childhood is torn away by complete, I don't know what they've diagnosed this guy as being. But how could anybody just go into a school and just shoot children point blank, not even, you know, intentionally? It's as crazy as it gets. But so, of course, our hearts go out to anyone that suffered, the families. You know, they'll never be their lives, will never be the same. But I have to say, at the end of the day, from a Jewish perspective, we read this week's chapter, we read about a boy that was once, thousands of years ago, almost killed. By whom? By his own brothers, actually. And instead of that, they ended up selling him into slavery. And you learn a lot about it. We still remember this boy, thousands of years later. Because what he did was he did not become a victim to his challenges. So, as mysterious or as strange as it sounds, and it's not a blessing in any way, you know, the key is to become stronger through our pain. And to learn that what we have to cherish, the value, the things that we usually ignore, you know. I'm not saying it's good news, but it's interesting to see how America suddenly wakes up and says, you know, what really matters. I mean, I have to say that President Obama said it right on target. If I was arrogant, I think he took it out of some of my articles that I wrote a few years ago. And that is that if you don't protect the children of your generation, you failed, period. It makes no difference what else you've done. Because what else do we really have that we can protect? And I'm not getting into the politics of who said it. By me, it's like someone says something, I'm not getting into it. The fact is that's, to me, the truth. And the true measure of a society is the welfare of our children, which is really the welfare of our families. Everything else is absolutely temporary. It's nice, great to have a high standard of living, it's great to have a lot of gadgets and all the toys and this. But what is it worth if children's lives are ripped away? What are all technologies worth? And I'm not saying this as a social critique, I'm just saying it as an opportunity to connect to some of what I was discussing before. What Jews always knew, and they suffered greatly, and Joseph suffered greatly, we suffered, but we never became sufferers. We learned to figure out how to access a deeper part of ourselves and to become more dignified, even in the face of indignity. And it's not like we want to, and it's not about anger or revenge. You know, I have no doubt, I don't know what the diagnosis of this Lanza, Adam Lanza is, but regardless of what they'll figure out about it, I have no doubt that we live in a world where life has become devalued. I remember it was 1979. There was another attack by a woman in San Diego. What was the name of the school? I forgot. So one day morning, she just took her rifle and started shooting kids. And she was caught. She did not commit suicide. And you know the thing that she said? This is documented. Check it out. She said, "Mondays are very boring. And I thought this would liven things up a bit." Now, I know when we hear that, it sounds like, is she healthy, not healthy? But there's something about our society that has like livened things up, like, you know, what about that that life has become devalued. And I think it comes down to how we see life and the dignity of life. And let's be frank, the fact is that whether we like it or not, we're all part of the problem, in the sense where the media and the whole perspective of life, violence and stuff like that, has become very frivolous. And in a way, it's due to the gift of freedom and prosperity and comfort zones. But that has created a deep apathy. And sadly, it's sad to say, but when we were suffering and oppressed by others, we valued life more. When we're free, I guess we start taking for granted this thing called life. And I know that's not a short-term solution. Short-term solution, maybe you need to have an armed guard in every school, as frightening as that sounds. And you need to deal with gun control or other things. But those are ultimately short-term solutions. The longest-term solution is how we treat our own children, what love we give them, and how they treat life with dignity. I have no doubt that even though you cannot have a foolproof solution to all massacres and murders and so on, but if dignity of life was taught as the most single greatest priority, and there's no question it would prevent quite a few murders. And I would say something even more. It's not just that not respecting someone else's life. I would say many of these people are able to take other lives because they don't respect their own lives. Life, period, has become somewhat of a negligible commodity. I know it sounds weird because we'd all do anything to save our lives, but think about it. There's something that has worn down, you know, 7 billion people. If, you know, how many of you think about how much bacteria are killed when you wake up in the morning? So if we're just evolved bacteria, okay, it's a big thing, a life here, a life there. I know it sounds obscene, but unfortunately, it's become part of a reality that is a virtual reality. On television, the violence we see, death, people are shot. It has to desensitize us, even though it's just a movie, or just a film, or just a television show. But you see enough of it, and people pay to see it, and they are attracted to it. So there's something happening in our consciousness. Anyway, I just wanted to throw in a few words about it. I didn't want to ignore that either. But above all, the focus is not on the negative, but on the positive, which is we have to do everything possible. I wrote an article last year when Leiby Kletsky, you remember, in our own little world, the Jewish world in Borough Park, last year, this little boy tragically killed, not by a murderer, not by this, by a fellow Jew who just decided to chop him up and shook everybody up till this day. The only good redeeming factor is that it has woken up the community to think about children more and molestation and all the other stuff. But I wrote that in an article, I think I called it World War III. You know, to me, the world war of our time is the war for our children. And it's a society that we have to begin to focus on it. Children are neglected. That's the bottom line. Even in families that have nannies and so on. You know that joke, but it's not such a joke, it's pretty tragic, where you have the story where this nursery school teacher realizes that one of the little kids is very clingy and seems to be very needy. So she decides, you know what, she's going to talk to the mother, woman to woman. She won't criticize her, but just tell the mother that maybe she should hug her child a little more and give her a little more love. TLC. So she sits down with her and tells the mother, you know, I don't want to bring up a sensitive topic, but your little boy seems to be very needy, and I think I want to make a suggestion that he needs a little more love at home. So the mother, without flinching, without blinking an eye, she says, yeah, you know, something is very true, because the therapist told us the same thing yesterday. And so I told our nanny that she should start hugging the little Charlie more. That was her response. So she has a nanny doing the hugging. So I understand the value of nannies, and I understand that everyone is two working parents and stuff like that. You know, sometimes you ask parents, so why are you working? Give security to our children. And I say, well, one second, maybe you're like taking away security while you're giving them security. Security means money. So I'm not, again, every situation has to be assessed, and I'm not suggesting that people shouldn't work and try to work, but I, you know, we have to end up time to time Just like in business, we end up, we have to review all our priorities. I think in our personal lives, we also have a good time to make be a little accountable and review our, what are our priorities. You know, even if your life is working, it's always good to look at it all again. So the third dimension is yours for the taking. But you have to do some things. There are certain prices to pay. And I hope to continue to develop this theme further. I think this was a good introduction, or also some specifics. But I will address this more. If you want to learn more about this, so I do give this daily class in Ayin Beis, which is on YouTube channel. It's a little heavier stuff. But if you want a little journey into the unknowns, onto the unknown, it can be a good exercise. Try it out. I study in text, but I explain everything in English. And I could, if you send me an email, I'd be happy to refer you to some key classes that discuss more of the details of this unconscious and unconscious. So more to come. And as always, it's a pleasure to speak to you all and share. And hopefully we all can touch that third dimension each other. At least once in a while. And again, thank you, Mark, for dedicating the class to the birthday boy, to his third dimension. He's thanking you from that place. And blessings to everybody. And I want to say, Philip back there will be giving his class tomorrow night about the third dimension as well, right? Okay. And now that all aware that there's this the real you, you know, as soon as you're aware, I guarantee you it's going to start popping its head more because it recognizes that you're aware of it. So everyone have a very pleasant week. We will be here next week as well. Please leave us your emails if you haven't done so. Any other announcements to make? Okay, that's good. Everyone have a very good week. Thank you so much.